morning and welcome.
Good morning.
It's lovely to be, as it were, playing at home today. I have a succession of away fixtures over the next few weeks, but it's nice to be here at St Andrew's on this third Sunday of Epiphany, which is also the Sunday in the week of prayer for Christian unity. We have to begin with a sad announcement, and I'm going to ask Steve if he would kindly come forward and tell us about the passing of one of our number.
Good morning. I have a statement that's been issued this morning. I am sorry to have to tell you the sad news that Richard Irons, well known and loved here at St Andrews, passed away peacefully in the early hours of Friday morning, this family around him. Richard's funeral will be here at St Andrews on Saturday, the 29th of January at 2 p.m, followed by burial in the churchyard, and then refreshments, currently expected to be at the beach hall. If you knew Richard, you are warmly invited to attend. There will also be a video link for those unable to attend. Please contact Jane, Richard's wife, for the link. Chris Cullors, who was a great friend of Richard, will be officiating. Jane asks that rather than flowers, donations be made to St Leonard's Hospice, whose staff cared wonderfully for Richard at home during his final few weeks. If you would like to attend the funeral, Jane asks that you please take a lateral flow test on the day and wear a mask. Please dress as you wish. If you are able to let Joan know you are coming, either in person or using Richard's email address, please do so to assist with catering. We of course remember Richard before God today with huge thanksgiving and hold Jane and the family in our prayers. There will be a copy of this note on the table at the end after service with Richard Irons' email address on it. And there's also a blank sheet for you to sign, for those who don't have access to a computer. If you'd like to put your name and telephone number saying you're attending, I'll leave that at the back of the room, and I will then send that on to Jane. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
We sing our opening hymn.
Thank you.
of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I should have mentioned at the start of this service that indeed today we are privileged to have as our preacher Tom. So I look forward very much, Tom, to hearing you speak as well as hearing you play as usual, and every blessing on you as we await your word. We say together our opening prayer. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are open, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We ask for God's forgiveness. The grace of God has dawned upon the world through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself for us to purify a people as his own. In that light, let us confess our sins. God be gracious to us and bless us, and make your face shine upon us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May your ways be known on the earth, your saving power among the nations. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You, Lord, have made known your salvation, and to reveal your justice in the sight of the nations. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The collect for today, the third Sunday in Epiphany. Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and miracles the wonder of your saving presence, renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by your mighty power through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Our next hymn is, we haven't had the Peruvian Glory, I do apologise. Do you want to have our Peruvian Glory now? Yeah. Sorry?
I can count on it.
All right.
To God be glory forever, to God.
him, "Will you come and follow me?"
Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have seen his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, and to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour." And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
chips up. It's my resident bastard. So Luke tells us in verse 20, I'm not reading, that Jesus rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. Well, things don't change an awful lot. I closed the Bible, that's why I walked that way, and I've sat down. And I suspect I can be seen from your pew. Sorry, folks. Anyway, I can be seen from all the pews, I think, without too much trouble. And the eyes of all of the people in the synagogue, I mean the church, may be fixed on me to see what comes next. Well, after that little journey, I'm not surprised. I must say that teaching from the sitting position is a tradition that is a relief from my point of view. So I couldn't allow my stool to be used elsewhere. Now, services in synagogues consisted of worship, reading some scripture, and then teaching. And where there were no professional rabbis in a synagogue, someone would be asked to stand up and lead, and read from the scriptures, and then do some teaching, rather like the way I've been asked. He would do some teaching based on what he'd read. Now, with the hindsight that we have, I assume that you're not as surprised as I reckon the Galileans of Nazareth were, that this local lad, a carpenter boot, had made such a name for himself around the synagogues of Galilee. He'd already done that. Most of us will be all too aware that rumours get around very quickly, especially in a close-knit community. So we can expect that a large number of the crowd had come to hear what this Jesus had to say for himself, or what was so special about him, not just to support him. Natural enough, he's invited to teach, and after reading the scripture, he sits down, taking the traditional rabbinic position to the teaching, and everybody is wondering what he, son of a well-known local carpenter, was going to make of the passage from the great prophet Isaiah that he'd been given to read. Now, this story of appearing before your home community resounds quite strongly with me too. For the first time I ever preached to a full congregation was at the Methodist church in my local village, the village where my father and his before him had been brought up. And the chapel was just about a quarter of a mile, barely, from my family home, and it was full of people, many of whom had known me since I was about 3 years old, when we were brought back to the family home. On top of that, Whaleys were known as staunch Anglicans, had been for hundreds of years. I attended our parish church and been a toddler. There's no toddlers playing on the floor today, are there? But that's what I used to play trains on the floor of the pew. And then I was in the choir, and then I always played the organ. So, you know, I was used to attending church locally. And there'd even been a number of Anglican ministers of my ancestors, as our family farm, as you probably are aware, only wants to support one of the sons, so everybody else went elsewhere, unless they were daughters, which they were married off. So the family was known in the village as a church-going family, but it was also known as a very strong supporter of this chapel, our local chapel, which it was still, in my mind, as a primitive Methodist chapel, based tight old-fashioned loop. Now, sitting or standing before that congregation was exciting at the start of my ministry. It was a small building, there were people there, there were people here. It's really quite weird. But the thing I remembered, that I was surrounded by members of a very tight-knit community who wanted to support and encourage me. I mean, it was great to be invited to take two services at that stage, to be with people who knew me and wanted me to succeed. And I'm not sure this was quite the same for Jesus, who seemed very determined to stir things up, which certainly wasn't part of my plan. He was stirring things up, but he got his ministry started, his ministry, his mission into gear. Now, you know, why did he come to Galilee and then on to Nazareth? And what was his plan and his vision? Well, Luke paints a picture for us in his story of Jesus getting stuck into his mission. Jesus has followed his baptism by John, and his retreat, with his temptation in the desert, and on those that lovely picture of the pinnacles of the temple in Jerusalem. And he's followed that by travelling out into the country, north to Galilee, which was so very different to Jerusalem. While it was not an out-of-the-way rural area, not like my corner of the Dales, I suppose, because it was densely populated with many large settlements, we'd hardly call them villages, and there were lots of synagogues. Law, remember, was where you had 10 families, you had to have a synagogue. That means quite a lot of synagogues, and quite a lot of meetings. Galilee, on the other hand, was probably the least conservative area of Palestine, associated as it was with people from other nations, associated with the Gentiles. People there, therefore, tended to be much more open-minded. So when Jesus confronts them with his very outgoing manifesto and his astounding declarations, he'd chosen an area where this message was much more likely to be heard and accepted, much more likely to make an impact. And then, as Luke envisages later, Acts and so on, his story could go out into the world amongst the Gentiles. Now we heard what Jesus led. The passage that forms the basis for his thought was from the prophecies of Isaiah. And this passage is all about God's plan for restoring a broken world and bringing in his kingdom. The Spirit of God is speaking to him. He's been anointed by God to bring good news to the poor, to heal the sick, demand release for the captives, uplift the downtrodden, and proclaim the kingdom of God. And then Jesus sat down, and I suspect he paused, looked at everybody, and then announced this astounding statement: today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. What a moment. What kind of reaction would we expect to receive if we'd read these words from Isaiah and then declared, well, folks, today, that promise in that prophecy has actually come true. I imagine a whole range of reactions. From first of all, some amount of surprise, really. Disbelief, what rubbish. Through shock, and maybe mockery. Goodness me, how dare he, one of our locals, say that. And perhaps, as we're used to, given up the current climate, even anger. How dare he? And violence in some cases. Now, Jesus making his declaration, it may seem a very sort of wildly brave sort of thing to do. But really, he's showing a prophetic boldness, a boldness that prophets really do need to show. And also an imaginative vision that this is the moment to declare that God is with us. God's reign has arrived with and in him. Now, bear in mind, at that time, even to picture God's power coming to set the oppressed people free would have been extremely challenging. Well, again, so what's changed? What's new? Setting people free? Uplifting the downtrodden? Well, I suggest that we as a church in this place need to see this declaration by Jesus as our mission statement too. A mission statement for our homes, for Bishopthorpe, for York, and hopefully in the country. That the sharing of Christ and the bringing in, the welcoming in of God's kingdom, of God's reign in and through our lives is what we need to be about. Along with Jesus, we should be starting in our own patch, which is what he did, and bring this wonderful news to bear on what we say and what we do. Jesus tells us that the work of God's kingdom is not simply about some sort of future event, some faraway Messiah figure. It's an invitation, not a really strong demand, for us to stand and work together now, and to get involved with bringing good news for the poor and the downtrodden, and healing for the sick, and freedom for captives. And hey, also announcing that God's kingdom is here now, and we have a part to play.
The inevitable liturgical fumble while I find my way through my out pocket to turn the microphone back on. Please stand. Let us declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
Using the intercessions from the Week of Prayer for Christian Unity. And I found to my pleasure that they put in as a response to each section, O Lord, hear my prayer. Now, some of you may know the Taizé version of this, and if you do, please join in. O Lord, hear my prayer. O Lord, hear my prayer. When I call, answer me. O Lord, hear my prayer. O Lord, hear my prayer. The Magi came from the East to pay homage and offer special gifts from their cultures and countries. We pray today for all Christian communities around the world in their diversity of worship and tradition. Lord, we ask you to preserve these treasures, particularly in areas of the world where the presence and survival of the church is threatened by violence and oppression. The early years of the Lord's life were marked by violence and massacres at the orders of the despot Herod. So we pray for children living in places in the world where violence continues and where its results are tangible. Strengthen, O Lord, the bonds of unity and mutual love among our churches. And help us to cooperate and witness to your holy name. Inspire us to work without ceasing in order to defend the oppressed and include the marginalized. Encourage us to stand together in the face of tyranny and oppressive regimes as we seek your kingdom among us. O Lord, hear our prayer. O Lord, hear our prayer. When I call, answer me. O Lord, hear our prayer. O Lord, hear our prayer. Come and listen. After the visit of the Magi, the Holy Family experienced migration through the wilderness and became refugees in the land of Egypt. Lord, we pray for all refugees and uprooted people in this world. Equip us, Lord, to show hospitality to those driven from their homes, and grant us the spirit of welcome to those looking for a safe haven. The birth of Jesus was good news for all, gathering people from different nations and religions in worship of the Holy Child. So we pray for our efforts to seek harmony and dialogue with other religions. Lord, give us humility and patience to walk with others with respect on their journey. O Lord, hear our prayer. O Lord, hear our prayer. When I call, answer me. O Lord, hear our prayer. O Lord, hear our prayer. Come and listen. The Magi returned to their homes by a different way. We pray for our churches in this changing world. Lord, help us to find new and creative ways to follow you and to witness to you so that the world may believe. Lord, we pray for all those who are in trouble, in pain or in sorrow. We pray especially today for the family of Richard as we remember him with pleasure and with joy. When the Magi saw the Holy Child, they rejoiced with great joy. Heavenly Father, fix our eyes on him so that we do not lose our way. Unite us in Lord Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. O Lord, hear our prayer. O Lord, hear our prayer. When I call, answer me.
Please stand for the peace. Mindful that this is the Sunday, the week of prayer for Christian unity, slightly different words to introduce the peace this morning. If our life in Christ means anything, if love can persuade at all, or the spirit that we have in common, or any tenderness and sympathy, then be united in your conviction and united in your love with a common purpose and a common mind. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I think we continue to exchange the peace in a restricted manner, so peace be with you. Peace be with you. Our offertory hymn is no doubt on the screen, but in book 51.
Thank you.
bread was scattered and then gathered and made one, so may your church be gathered into your kingdom. Glory to you, O Lord, forever. Wisdom has built her a house, she has mixed her wine and has set her table. Glory to you, O God, forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all. Father, Lord of all creation, in your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us.
He opened his arms and love upon the cross
and made for all the perfect sacrifice. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father,
do this in remembrance of me.
His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father,
we do this in remembrance of me. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising to glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord most high. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. know the practice for receiving communion now, please come forward. I shall say the words of administration generally before administering the sacrament. And if you wish to receive a blessing rather than the host, then please bring a booklet or a hymn book or something with you as you come. I think you rotate. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Let us pray. Lord God, the bright splendor whom the nations seek, may we, who with the wise men have been drawn by your light, discern the glory of your presence in your Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ our Lord, to whom kings bow down in worship and offer gifts, reveal to you his glory and pour upon you the riches of his grace, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Our final hymn is Brother, Sister, Let Me Serve You. Expecting to do something, or they're just trying to make a quick getaway. Yes, go in peace and love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.